So tonight we are talking with Bob Bones, who was the production stage manager for many years for American Musical Theater of San Jose. We worked together for many years, and it's great to have you here tonight. And Alex, who is an SBMT and Silicon Valley Shakespeare stage manager, and they will be talking all of the ins and outs of stage management. Hello, thank you guys so much for joining me tonight and joining us and giving us a behind the curtain peek at stage management. So I'm going to start with Bob. Tell us a little bit about yourself and why you're here tonight.
Well, I'm here tonight because Sara called me, and as Sara mentioned, we worked together for many years, several years at American Musical Theater. I came to San Jose Civic Light Opera back in 1989, which is a long time ago. Diana Schuster brought me out. But briefly, I mean, I went to college, have a degree in theater and sociology. Initially, I thought I wanted to be a director or a designer, and I ended up getting an internship at the Alley Theater in Houston, working in the scene shop, and realized I didn't want to be a carpenter my whole life. And due to an injury that I got, I had an opportunity to work with the stage managers backstage on the shows. And I'd never really considered stage management, but from that moment on, I realized that was kind of the direction I wanted to go in. So I started pursuing that more. And through different jobs, opportunities that came up in summer stock theater, and then at the Alley Theater, I pursued that further, and I was able to get my equity card. And through connections, I worked for a musical theater company in Houston called Theater Under the Stars. And Diana Schuster came out to direct a production of Evita there. And that's where I met her. And then when they had an opening in San Jose, they contacted me and to see if I was interested in moving to San Jose for the job. So I'd also worked with the current production stage manager, Bud Coffey, who was here at the time in Sacramento. And so between he and Diana's, the connection there, they brought me out to San Jose to work. And I've always loved musical theater. I did straight, non-musical theater for a while. Just as a stage manager, it's more interesting, more challenging, and I love musicals, so just made it a perfect fit. I've done some touring. I've also worked for ballet companies, and I currently work. And then, so I just go back up a little bit. After American Musical Theater closed, I still did some stage managing on some touring companies, but I was transitioning into production management, which is what I do now. Out of necessity somewhat, out of a little bit more of job security. And fortunately, because of that, I was able to find other work after American Musical Theater shut down. And I recently transitioned, well, recently, 5 years ago, I was hired by Team San Jose, who manages all the venues now downtown. And so I'm actually the production manager at the CPA, which is kind of funny after having worked there for 20 years as a stage manager. So it's, and like a lot of people, I'm not working currently, but I hope to go back this summer sometime. So, that's a brief history.
Right. 20 years at, with American Musical Theater is quite impressive. And, when we shared this with the AMT and SJ CLO Facebook alumni group, there was quite an outpouring of love and appreciation for Bob and his many, many years there of just what a great person. And really that company was known very much for having a wonderful sense of community and a family environment that nurtured new actors, new performers, and very much, Bob, you were a key component of that. So yay, we're incredibly grateful that you're here to share with us. And then I'm going to throw it over to Alex to kind of to give us the same thing, a little background on your experience and how you got into stage management.
Yeah, so I have not been stage managing for 20 plus years. But I've been involved in theater kind of my entire life, as many of us start out as. I was primarily a performer. And I went to Concordia University, and I got a degree in something called theater and development, which is I kind of call it like a hippie program. It's very much community-based, or like theater for specific purposes, so like political cabarets, drama therapy, all of that's kind of lumped into that program. And I started applying, or I started auditioning for some of the main stage productions. And one of the years, I think it was maybe my second or third year, I was looking at the shows, and I just didn't see anything for me. There was one show that was going to be, they were doing Angels in America. So I was like, okay, that's 90% dudes. and there was another puppet show, and I just didn't really see myself as a puppeteer. So I decided instead to apply as an ASM, so an assistant stage manager that year. And I got involved in the puppet show that year. So my first ever stage managing gig, I was the assistant stage manager, was a puppet show. And for those who don't know much about what ASMs do, they're usually in charge of the props and costumes. So in this case, the entire show, all of the puppets and everything was my thing. And I loved it. It was a little overwhelming for a hot second, and then I just really got into it and I absolutely loved it. So the next year I also didn't bother auditioning for any of the shows, and I applied to be a stage manager. And I, again, was able to get in that time as a stage manager for another, I think, probably the most technically heavy show I've done so far in my, I think, 8 years of stage managing. There was like trapdoors involved and flies and all that stuff, and it was a lot of fun. And I just kind of got into it. And then from that point on, I was really lucky. I got my first equity job, like right out of university, as a stage manager. And then I moved to California and couldn't work. So the equity thing went by. that left pretty quickly. But from there, I got involved with Silicon Valley Shakespeare and SBMT. And I did some work with some children's theater companies in the Bay Area, and mostly just kept busy there. And I've been lucky enough to have back-to-back projects kind of since I got out of university, which has been great, until, you know, theater stopped. So, and then 2020 happened, and I too have been unemployed. Yeah.
You guys both, you mentioned Actors Equity Union. Actors Equity is the union for both performers as well as stage managers. So they are not, I don't know if lumped in is quite the right word, but one of the movements that is happening recently is the stage management arm of Actors Equity is pushing for a little bit more representation of stage managers. I just thought that was, you know, good background. There are a number of contracts that are in the world for equity. South Bay Musical Theater is not a union house, but some of the bigger ones in this region are. Stage managers are just simply the best. They really do, from a manager or producer's point of view, they are, if you imagine a theater company like a wheel, stage management is that center hub of the wheel with all of the different departments coming out of that. So you've got your costumes, your props, set, the cast, the musicians, everything filters in right through that center hub of stage management. When we start rehearsals, this is a little bit of an org chart just to show where a stage manager might play in. And theater is such a anomaly in how it is structured. So you do start with producer and board. Director would technically be in the top. Every theater company is always laid out a little bit differently. For us, I very much rely on our production manager, director, and stage management to communicate primarily, and then from there we filter down. Director will interact directly with the designers, same with the production manager, stage manager, as well as communicating anything from the director, the production manager to the designers that might come up during rehearsal as well. The stage managers brought in kind of right at the beginning of pre-production of the show itself. Do you guys want to talk a little bit about what you do for pre-production prep?
I mean, the main thing is obviously reading the script initially, listening to the music, if you have, you know, if it's on CD, if you're familiar with it, getting to know it as much as possible. There's, and Alex can speak to this as well, but I mean, there's, I would often do a breakdown, which is kind of go through the script and write down notes about costumes or props or scenery or, you know, sound cues or anything that, that is mentioned in the script, make a note of it under each scene. So I could just start getting organized with that information before we go into rehearsals.
For sure. I think a big thing that I make sure to do before the start of rehearsals is prepare my actual prompt book. So I'll usually print out kind of blocking pages. If the designers provide it that early, I'll put a little, I guess like, not a cutout, but the breakdown-ish of what the set will look like so that I can do the blocking notes. There you go, that's my problem.
I'm lucky enough that Alex didn't want to move this back to Canada with her, so she gifted it to me. So excited. And so, yeah, there is, I'm going to pull out one of these sheets.
Yeah. And I number all of the lines. So it's really nice when I get a soft copy of it and print it myself because I don't have to hand do that, but usually I'll put on an episode of Gilmore Girls and I'll do all the lines.
Got a little set there on a blocking page and then all of your numbers.
Yep. Yeah. And then tricks of the trade is that I always hole punch all of my pages on both sides because when I'm in rehearsal, I want the blocking page to be on my right side because I'm right-handed. But then when it comes to tech, I actually swap the pages and that way I can write on the actual like text pages. So that's a little trick of the trade that I usually do. It's all little prep works. A lot of it is very mindless. So I put on some episodes of Gilmore Girls and I spend a couple hours kind of half paying attention to what I'm doing.
Yeah, the detail, I mean, one of the biggest skill sets of any stage manager is real attention to detail, organization, very much up your, both of your alleys immensely.
Yeah, and it's a lot of work you have to do on your own kind of before.
Yeah.
I mean, ideally you have prep time that you're being paid for, you know, or that you're doing before the rehearsal start. They're supposed to be. So you can, yeah, you can do that. You can prep your script. You can gather all the information that you need to. Because once rehearsals start, you'll be behind already if you don't have all that stuff done in advance. So it's, if they don't give you time, you have to find time on your own to do that. So.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah. As we get in, you, Bob mentioned a little bit about scene breakdown and looking at what is, laid out as far as the cast and track. So you pulled up, talk to us a little bit about this scene breakdown, which is from Miss Saigon.
It's a scene breakdown. We did it at AMT for Miss Saigon. A lot of the times this was done mainly for wardrobe as well as for the cast to know what they were doing. But as you can see, this was from the middle of the show, but there was, you know, we broke down scene 7, obviously was a couple scenes because it says 1-7-B. And mainly it was to keep track for like the ensemble, especially because they're constantly changing costumes or characters. So if you follow down the second half of that chart, you know, there's these are all the ensemble members. So, you know, Ricky Valoria, the second Asian man, you know, he's Soldier 2, then he was in the Gun Dance, and he went back to Soldier 2, then he was the Dragon Head. You know, so they're constantly changing costume and what they were doing in the show. There again, it was for us to keep track of where they were, who they were, and for costuming and sound to be able to track, you know, what they were doing and where they needed to be. So this was information that usually was compiled with the director and the choreographer and costumes. usually it was information that we would create and publish, but we didn't make the decisions. And which is a lot of what stage management is. Put together the information, disseminate it. But this was a way of keeping track, especially when you get into rehearsals, which we'll talk about more later. But, you know, if the director says I'm doing act one, scene 10, and then you need to put together a schedule and let those people know who's in that, then you can refer to this chart and hopefully be able to do that. So
that's why it's important that there's no mistakes in it, because that happened to me. I was supposed to call someone who is important for a scene, but they weren't in my breakdown and they did not get called for that day. And it was very awkward.
Due diligence is, the name of the game, almost like Santa. He's checking the list and checking it twice. Oh yeah, that's what it is. Stage
and some of these things change constantly all the way up to opening, because sometimes they'll decide they won't know maybe until they actually try the costume change or a crossover that somebody can't make it or isn't available for it or who knows, you know. And this also comes in handy down the road when you're dealing with understudies or injuries or things like that. So
now when it would be that close to opening, would you go back and re-update this sheet? Reprint, redistribute?
It depends on time. A lot of times I would just cross things out manually and just do it. I mean, if the shows were going to run longer than a week or two, yeah. So for a touring show, yes, you would do that. You would redo it, send it out again. But for a show that only runs for a couple of weeks, you're probably not going to revisit. I would just make the note manually and not worry about it. So. Yeah.
We also talked a little bit about, and let's talk a little bit about production meetings. Production meetings were one that invaluable to have the stage manager there, but also something that, depending on this, on the company, who's running that, what are the goals of those production meetings?
Alex, do you want to go?
Sure. I think, honestly, every single company that I've worked at has run production meetings differently. I was always taught that traditionally one of the big roles of stage management in that is that we take the meeting minutes. But then again, sometimes production managers do that. I think production meetings are very valuable because it's one of the few times that you have the entire staff together in one room. And that's when you learn who doesn't read emails. But yeah, sometimes the stage manager, I think the thing about being a stage manager is that you have to be quite flexible, right? I sometimes go in with certain expectations of what's expected of me, and then I end up just kind of sitting there because other people are it's their company. They've been there for a long time. They've got ways of doing things. And that's cool, you know? Yeah.
I mean, my experience was, it's changed as well over time. I mean, I've run the meetings as the production stage manager. I've run them as a production manager. I've not run the meetings. I mean, sometimes the artistic director would do it. Sometimes the director would do it. And it doesn't really matter. I mean, the main point is to get everyone together, all the designers and the creative staff and the shop staffs and everything, and talk about the show and answer people's questions, talk about potential issues, talk about budget if you have to, talk about schedule. Because it's rare to get everyone together in the same room. Normally, we would try to have a production meeting, every couple of weeks. Weekly was not doable with people's schedules and traveling from all over the place. So it was not even, but I've worked for some companies where we did do production meetings every week. So
I actually love that. I loved when it was production meetings every week. It was standard. I knew that nothing was going to be falling behind too much, because that sometimes happens. And sometimes there would be a designer who couldn't show up, and that was fine. They just have to read the minutes. But yeah, it's ideal, I think.
Yeah, oh, absolutely. It was hard sometimes because everyone comes into the meeting kind of with their own agenda, which makes sense. They have their own area of expertise that they're worried about. So sometimes they can run several hours. I mean, so if you do them more frequently, hopefully they're a shorter meeting, which is one thing.
Right.
We've had them, if we had one or two, if we only had them every couple of weeks, sometimes they could run 2 or 3 hours just to get through everything. So that can be tedious. But
it definitely depends on whether you have a full-time staff. AMT was lucky in the fact that we had a stage manager. I was company manager at that point. There was an artistic director in-house. There was a master carpenter in-house, technical director in-house. So there was some of the designers. Right. That is real helpful. For us now, for SBMT, I generally assign. We have three pre-production meetings spaced out leading up two before rehearsals start and then one right before load in. And then when we move into the theater, then it becomes kind of about every week with every night on tech week, just for the designers to get together and put their heads together. It's one of the most wonderfully collaborative moments that just really fill my soul of having all of that group together.
Yeah. I just saw part of a question somebody posted about how Zoom may affect. I don't know. It'll be interesting to see. I mean, I think it could be a great help in some ways for those people that can't come on site. I mean, sometimes at AMT, we'd have directors or designers from out of town that, we wouldn't bring in the town till tech week. So that would help a lot with that. But there's nothing really to substitute for in-person, because the other thing that would happen in production meetings, I think, is even after the meeting's over, people would break off into smaller groups to go look at the set or the costumes, or to have other meetings about more specific things that not everyone had to be a part of. So that might not be as easy, although I guess you can still do that on Zoom. I think it could be of help, definitely.
I almost feel like a hybrid would be kind of the best one. But for kind of the major presentations, I feel like in person is still useful. Specifically, I'm thinking set. Usually they have maquettes, which is quite useful when the director can actually touch it and move it around and see how everything interacts. There's definitely, you can't beat that. You can't do that on Zoom. But for the weekly check-ins, this would be great. I would be able to do it in my PJs at 9 o'clock before going to rehearsal,
Yeah.
We can keep Alex, who did stage manage our Pride and Prejudice, which was with our co-production with Silicon Valley Shakespeare back in February. So, we're keeping her in the game.
You wear PJs.
And then you can wear PJs. Who knows what's on the bottom half? I am seeing some of the comments, and I will get to them, I do promise. But I'm going to go ahead and jump ahead to rehearsals. And let's talk about what happens during rehearsals, what's going on.
Yeah, I mean, one of the things for pre-production that we didn't talk about was, and maybe Alex mentioned it, we look at the set design, and oftentimes, obviously, we won't have the set in rehearsal. We have to tape out the floor, so you have to measure out the set, you have to put tape marks on the floor for where the set is, in addition to gathering props, costume pieces, things like that, so...
So actually, I mean, this is a random thing, but I think I have taped out the floors for maybe two shows I've ever worked on, because all the shows that I've worked on, all of the set pieces move. Like it's just always, I don't know if I'm just lucky or if that's kind of a trend in scenic design. But because everything was moving, we'd get kind of creative where we'd put like pylons where they were, where the playing space was and stuff like that. But I feel like it's a skill I actually have to relearn because I have not really used it since university.
Yeah, we were fortunate at AMT, actually, where the rehearsal hall was right next to the scene shop and pretty big. So we could actually, if the set was ready, we could actually bring pieces in and use that. So,
the dream.
But still, it was, it's not fun. I don't enjoy taping out a floor, but it has to be done sometimes.
Yeah. It breaks my brain.
always a challenge. Scheduling, good times. I do have... So this, Alex, I'll let you talk about this page.
So this is the schedule. Usually, again, in Canada, it worked a little bit different where the stage manager would put all this together. I found the kind of community theaters that I worked with in the Bay Area, the director actually does most of this work, which is fantastic. And then if anything, I'll just go in and make it pretty. Because sometimes it's not entirely legible. So I'll go in and make sure it's extra clear. The conflicts is definitely something that I think is unique to community theater. When you're paying people, they tend to be there. but with community theater, it's a passion project on the side, right? So you have lots of days where, oh, I couldn't get a babysitter, or I have a work meeting that came up, blah, blah, blah. So you've got to be a lot more flexible. So this definitely, I tend to use in that setting, Google Doc schedules, so that people can, so I can edit live. And then I'll also send out daily schedules, just to extra confirm and people don't forget it. Because I've definitely had it where actors will look at the first schedule and put it all in their calendar, and they won't notice when there's changes, as there oftentimes are. So that's kind of the gist of that.
Yeah, it's easy. No, it's complicated. And again, due diligence and double checking. So legibility, we'll talk about that and now. This is Bob's schedule.
Well, this is just a daily. So we would do a master schedule like you just saw, kind of for the whole process of rehearsal through tech and opening. And then we would do a daily schedule, which I would type up as well, but this was just a handwritten version of it. And basically across the top, it's the director, choreographer, music director, as you see, wardrobe. I think Brian was an associate musical director. And we were fortunate enough to have multiple rooms. So they would break down the schedule as far as what was happening, in which room, who was where, and when the break was. As you see, there's a bunch of people under wardrobe, costume fittings, things like that. So this is something where I would sit down. The daily schedule usually would happen the night before. So, you know, I'd sit down with the director on a break, hopefully before the end of the night, and they would give me the schedule for the next day. And then usually as far as what they wanted to do was up to them. I would point out any potential conflicts. And then I would usually get a list from costumes who they needed to see for fittings yet. And then it was kind of up to me and the stage management team to figure out when we could fit those people in based on the schedule and when they're being used. So, and sometimes all you can do is you have to pull somebody out of rehearsal and you just have to tell the director that so-and-so is going to be gone for an hour because they have to do this costume fitting. Because we go into tech next week and they'll be naked if we don't. So, you know, it's just, but hopefully you try to work around that. Hopefully you try to accommodate to where they don't miss somebody. But it's happened where I've scheduled someone, they weren't going to be used in rehearsal. Then the director changes their mind and they need them in rehearsal and they're in a costume fitting. You know, I mean, it's, or the costume fitting runs long, or, you know, things always, you know, so you're playing the role of, you know, communicating as well as, hopefully easing any stress about it, you know, telling the director they'll be here in 5 minutes, or you'll get to tell costumes that you'll get the person there, you know, tomorrow, or whatever you need to do. So it's, you're constantly juggling to try to please everybody.
Right. Communication, huge component. We were talking a little bit too about the advent of cell phones and how that made life so much easier, but also harder to disconnect. The being on all the time. However, making those communications and being able to text people of, hey, where are you? Or so-and-so is running late is incredibly beneficial. Communication too comes in with rehearsal reports. And these are just a sample from both Alex and from Bob. So talk just a little bit about your rehearsal reports.
My scribbles. Mine was this thing where we would usually rehearsal, you know, into the evening like you guys do as well. And I wanted to leave something, you know, most of our staff being on site, I wanted to leave something in their mailbox when I left at night, or be able to scan it and email it to them quickly that night. So they would have notes for the morning when they came in and I wasn't there. So I would usually just scribble things down, and they got used to reading my scrawl so that they could at least be aware. They maybe won't understand what it means, but they'll know that there's a note about, you know, we're adding something or we're changing something. And then it also was my way of noting, you know, when we took breaks, because being an equity partial equity company, you know, it was important to know, you know, to take the 5 or 10 minute breaks at certain times. So it was my way of keeping track of that and recording that in case anyone had a question about it later on. So
I like that idea. I'm going to steal that. Yeah, I mean, same thing, really. I find this, I like to go through the rehearsal reports with the director at the end, because, so my stage management coach basically taught me to be a professional eavesdropper. So wherever the director is, I have half an ear on them. And this is where they learn that. And a lot of the times they'll be surprised that I heard that, or they'll say something as a joke. And I'll have to kind of be like, so was this real life? Was this a joke? And it's really a toss up. Sometimes it's real life and sometimes they don't even remember saying it. So actually, I think it's actually more real time, more real life than not, if I'm being entirely honest. But yeah, and I just go through that. I try not to repeat notes too many times. So if you look at props, the note 4 is please see costume note 1. And that's just kind of saving my time. And also it's how I kind of help prioritize of this directly affects, in this case, it's the dressing room assignments. This is a costume thing, but props does need to know this because oftentimes designers just look at it very, very quickly and just read their own notes, which I mean, I do the exact same thing. So that's completely human, but it just helps to make sure that everybody's on the same page. Mm-hmm.
And I would add to that too, you mentioned about eavesdropping. I think that stage managers don't really take a break. I mean, usually when the company's on a break, that's when you are hanging out with the director or the choreographer or the music director and either getting information from them about the schedule, what they want to do next, or eavesdropping and finding out things. I don't smoke, but one of the directors and choreographers we used a lot early on did. And so I would end up going outside and hanging out with him while I smoked so we could talk and, you know, I could find out what's going on or I would not know what was happening, you know? So it just was, so you just have to realize you have to take your breaks judiciously and at times when you won't be missed. You know, if you're running a dance number 15 times, maybe you sneak out to the restroom then and leave one of your assistants there in charge and, you know, grab a cup of coffee or whatever you need to do.
Absolutely. So. Yeah. And I think even to add to the eavesdropping thing, I think it's because, so directors oftentimes they'll have these conversations and they won't remember to loop in the stage manager. And it's nothing against that. It just, I think directors' jobs in a lot of ways is to be present in the moment and stage manager's jobs is to make sure there's consistency. So it's us who has to actually note it down, make sure we remember it. Because a lot of directors, they're so in the moment that they'll say something and it'll be like, and then all of a sudden we'll remind them of it and be like, yes, actually I did like that idea. Let's keep that, let's make it happen. And then it's oftentimes the stage managers that then loop in the other people needed to actually make that stick. And I think as we mentioned, we're also the ones who write blocking notes. Always use a pencil for that because they will change. And I oftentimes actually, I don't even really erase the blocking notes. I just cross them out because oftentimes we'll go back and be like, what were we originally doing? And then I've got all that information there. So I think, yeah, stage managers, it's just a lot about making sure that everything's consistent and nothing gets lost. Yeah.
Yep. Great. I do remember stories of there was a certain director who would like to try out many different blocking arrangements and then go back to, well, let's pull this one from 4. So that, that, you know, reminding of the keeping all those blocking notes. And at the end of the night, you guys, I did pull a couple of names of great books that will give you more details about how to do things like notating blocking, which is not easy. I mean, it's Bob writes in hieroglyphs anyway, but Alex, this is rather neat. And, but it does take some training to know about that. So then we move into the theater and we move kind of in straight into tech weeks. SBMT personally is lucky. We have a luxurious 3 weeks in the theater to adjust. The first week is usually spent getting to know the set and finishing the set. Then the second week is when we pull in the house lights. And then the third week is the rest of the elements kind of layer on top of that. So then I included this wonderful picture of Alex testing out doing her safety check on the Big River raft with our choreographer, Esther.
Very Self. Important work is happening during this picture. Yes. I would like to note.
It's very, very funny. Good.
It's a very important safety check.
So talk a little bit, you know, start there. Talk to us a little bit about safety, because that's real.
So, I mean, I was mostly joking about the safety check, but actually that was a picture from Big River. And that was the raft that we were on that was on wheels and didn't have brakes. So one of the first things I did, even when it was still in the studio when we were playing around with it, was I leapt onto that thing and I moved around and I did all sorts of wonky things that we would never ask the actors to do. But I think it's just important for me to know the boundaries of it. And then if the director is suggesting things that I think might not be particularly safe, then I can have an educated view on things, and I can say we should modify to this because of this, blah blah blah. I always the first time I walk onto a set, I don't let any of the actors come on yet. And I'll point out things, Doug, I'll point out things that aren't quite finished that the designer usually has left. I'll make sure to talk to the designer before the actors go on the set. And then I actually have the actors walk around it, and step on things and blah, blah. And I will have them point out things that maybe I missed. So a lot of times they'll find like a screw on the ground or a screw that's sticking out. And sometimes I can fix it right away and sometimes I can't. Maybe I'll just put some like bright yellow gaff tape on it, or just make sure that everybody's aware so that they can be careful, because usually when you first go into the space, the sets are still a construction zone. They're still a work in progress. So we have to be extra cautious during that time.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, it's up to us to, as the stage managers, to have an eye on the big picture, because, you know, the carpenters, the designers, they're worried about their own specific area and getting their own little thing done. And when you have a group of people putting a set together, yeah, they're not noticing all the little screws and nuts and bolts and what might be an issue for an actor, and they get tired and, you know, they're just trying to get it done. So it is keeping an eye on the big picture, and ideally, and it's mentioned here about doing a dry tech. I mean, ideally, yes, we have time to be on the set before the cast is. In the ideal world, you have time to do a dry tech, which is basically going through all the cues with the crew before there are any actors on stage, so that the crew is familiar with the set and how it works, and you make sure that it is working safely and things are moving the way they're supposed to before you add the cast to the show. That doesn't always happen. It wasn't possible early on with AMT to have that time to do that. So there are some issues because of that. We can discuss later. But yeah, it's in the ideal world, you have, you know, several days or, you know, to walk through the show and check everything before you just try to run it. You know, it's just too dangerous to do that. So
I think as a general rule, and this is nothing against actors, it's just a fact of life. If an actor can break or hurt themselves on something, they will.
And if they can't, then it's going to be me, because I'm easily done with that. So paper tech is walking through with the lighting designer and the sound designer generally of all of the cues that would then form the book that then is in every time a scene shifts happens, the cues are called. Every time a lighting shift happens, the lighting cue is called, and so on and so forth. Just so real quick, I'm going to move to the next slide, which is our, this is just a sample of the She Loves Me schedule. These are 3 weeks in the theater from when we load in through until we opened there. So it's, as you can see, everybody's all hands on deck. This is where the production report or the rehearsal reports become very invaluable, as that they're communicating issues to the carpentry crew that can come in and fix. Not all your designers are there every night. It being a community theater, that's kind of lighting designers there most of the time, but sometimes our set designer isn't available to be at all rehearsals. So it's communicating. We really rely on those rehearsal reports to get all that information out. Same thing with, oh, this set piece, this wheel on the raft is wonky. Can you guys take another peek at it to keep things moving real smooth? And then, so then we move into performances. After opening night, kind of the job changes, because your top design staff, they're gone. They walk away. They get to go, bye, I've opened the show. The director's job is done. And the stage manager really does take the helm. You guys want to talk a little bit about the stage manager's responsibilities once the show is open?
Sure. I mean, yeah, as Sarah mentioned, I mean, it's typically the stage manager, the director leaves, the choreographer leaves. The main responsibility is finished. So as a stage manager, we're responsible for maintaining the show and not just calling the cues, but also making sure that that technically and artistically the show stays the way the director and designers left it and want it to be. So, that means taking notes. It means giving notes to the cast, to the crew, making sure that things remain safe. The timing of things is still accurate. And it's collaborating with the musical director, with your crew, because sometimes, I don't know, Alex, sounds like you were in a booth maybe out front, but I mean, I often, most of the time I called from backstage.
You mean
so
like
I had a video monitor. Oh, thanks. look, I had hair. You had a video monitor, as you see there. So I was off stage right.
Interesting.
So I had a video monitor of the stage and one of the conductor. Obviously being musical, a lot of cues came off of the conductor. So that way I could anticipate his or her downbeats or cutoffs. With the one monitor. So I would rely oftentimes on, the crew that was out front, my spot operators, like Carol, who's on this, I think, and, the light board operator, things like that to help me see things sometimes. And then oftentimes, if the show runs long enough, the production stage manager will have one of the assistants call the show, and the production stage manager will go out front and watch and take the notes. That happens a lot on touring shows where the PSM really is maintaining the quality of the show, and they will often watch the show and give notes, and the assistants alternate calling the show so that you're able to do that. So.
Awesome. So we have two samples. These guys pulled together two samples. It's most of our audience never even knows. A good stage manager is there, we hope, but we really don't ever see them, ever hear them. They're just magically making things happen and making the show look so very effortless. So to pull the curtain aside, we have prepped two little segments of these guys calling two of the shows that they have worked on.
Let's see. So disclaimer, I haven't called this show for 10 years. And it's going to be a section from Joseph and the Amazing Technicolor Dreamcoat, somewhere near the beginning. It's just a short section. The only thing I'll explain is the things happening in this are some lighting changes, some spot cues, and then there are things that I will refer to as rail cues, which are fly rail. And then there are winch cues, which are also fly cues. That the CPA is kind of unique in that some of the fly lines are actually automated winches. So some things that would normally be also fly cues were run by winches that were actually run from the deck. So the fly rail at the CPA is actually about 20 feet off the floor on stage right, and is operated from gentlemen, women or men up there pulling ropes. And then the winches are operated from usually one person on the deck stage right, pushing a button. And they would be communicated with via headset, but also with cue lights. So there might be, not that you'll be able to read my scribbling, but the cue lights are usually red or blue. And so a light, in addition to giving a verbal cue, I would also have a series of cue lights that I would turn on and turn off. Turning on the cue light was a stand, and turning off the cue light was the go. So that way, on the fly row, oftentimes you might have 3, 4, or 5 people pulling ropes, and they can't all maybe hear what you're saying. So the cue light was their cue to go at the same time, so that hopefully it all happened the way it's supposed to. Where lighting and spots are always usually just verbal cues. Spotlights, I'll try to throw in some of the specifics, but oftentimes, and if Carol wants to chime in at some point, oftentimes your spotlight operators get to know the show well enough, and they pretty much do the show for you, so you don't have to say too much once you get through opening. They make you look good. So, but initially in tech, you know, I would give a lot more information about the intensity that they're at, what frame color they're in, who they're on, things like that. But once we got into opening, got the end of the run of the show, the spot operators pretty much knew what they were doing. They were also given cue sheets by the lighting designer, but a spot operator doesn't really have time often to look at the cue sheets. Maybe in advance they could, but if they have a series of cues coming up, they do rely on the stage manager to help them out and help them through that and at least give them a standby of what's happening. And oftentimes a go, because sometimes if they change the lights, it's important to do that. So anyhow, so this is just a short section from Joseph. Yeah, so we'll see how bad it is. Stand by, electric 13, spot one up the half, we're going to get the full body. Electric 13, spot one. Go. Stand by in rails B, C, and D. Stand by winch cues A and B. And usually the crew is on headset talking to you at the same time. And we are still waiting. Still electric 14 and winch A. Any dream will go. Rail B. Go. Electric 15, rail C and winch B. Go. Electric 16, spot 2 fading out with Joseph Exit, rail B. Go. Electric 17. Go. And so I didn't kill anybody.
It's so exciting. No, nothing's landed on anybody's head. So it is really fun. I mean, the chatter that the stage management does on headset behind the stage is just really nonstop. Now, obviously, that was at the Center for Performing Arts in downtown San Jose, a little bit bigger than the Saratoga Civic Theater. So thank you. Thank you, Bob. That was...
Well, and as Alex will tell you, I mean, that was, you know, that's after meeting with the designers, being through weeks of rehearsal, that's, you know, teching the show. I mean, that you practice these things, you know, through tech and refine what you're doing. I mean, as does the whole crew. So, you know, it just doesn't happen. It doesn't just roll off the tongue first time through like that.
So. 10 years. You could do it next year if we had the chance. All right, Alex, you ready?
Yeah. And then I also actually just wanted to add for context, in a lot of theaters, the reason why the stage manager calls the show is that A, all the tech happens at the same time, and B, I'm doing like A and B, anyways, whatever. and B, oftentimes the stage manager is the only one who can actually see the full picture. So I've had it where the sound person can hear, but they can't actually see anything that's happening. Same thing. Usually we'll let the lighting person, if there is an extra spot, we'll make sure the lighting person can see and the sound person can hear, but they don't see the action. And the stage manager is also the only one who is there throughout the entire process. So they're kind of able to kind of get a feel for the show and really understand it on an artistic level and not just a technical. Whereas the people who are running the light and sound boards, sometimes it's the stage manager, but oftentimes you have operators, they only join in tech week. So they just have a much less intimate knowledge of the show. So if things go a little bit wonky, they won't necessarily know how to adapt that. So that's just some context as to why on earth a stage manager does this as opposed to just getting the individual parties to do their thing, like machines. But yes, okay, share screen.
Very cohesive. It's the She Loves Me, our most recent production was closed back in February.
Yeah. The last one before COVID.
A simple chemical reaction. You see, sometimes when two people like each other very much, they like each other? Oh, I think so. They like each other very much? Well, don't you think we should tell them?
Alex, 296, snow.
They never believe us. Look,
go.
Winter.
Alex, 298, spot two. Go.
Dear friend. Have you set your calendar
Alex, 299,
for Tuesday?
Spot one.
When we bring this chapter
go.
To a close, when I meet my lady of the letters, who puts tiny faces in her own.
Alex, 302, spot two.
December,
go.
Until then, count the
Alex, 303,
hours.
Spot one.
I'm late for work. I'm late.
Go. Alex 304. Go.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Am I there?
That's that. And then I don't know if you all noticed, but sometimes tech things would happen without me calling them. And that's usually because the lighting designer, it's always a dialogue between the lighting designer and the stage manager of figuring out what the stage manager should call and what should be follow cues. So in this instance, I called one cue into the transition, so it went into the blackout and then automatically went into the transition light. It's just a lot easier if that's a timed thing in that instance, as opposed to me just kind of guessing the time. If it's something that needs to be the exact same every night, sometimes it's better to just have the tech do it because stage managers are humans. I know we don't talk about that often, but still humans, not robots.
Darn, don't drop those secrets, man.
Great secrets.
I saw somebody asked about if we use a score because of some of the cues being with the music, which they often are. And I've done it both ways. For Joseph, I did not use a score. I knew the music well enough, and by having a video on the conductor, I could watch when Billy gave an upbeat or a downbeat, and I could anticipate that and call the cue with that. There are shows where I think Tommy and Miss Saigon, where I did use a score, and Alex can speak to this. I mean, the problem with using a score is it's. I didn't bring a sample of it, but the script, your binder is like triples in size.
Yeah.
And it's also hard because you're flipping so many more pages to keep up with it. Sometimes what you do is you kind of do a hybrid where you maybe will have the score for sections of the show where it's just music, like a dance section or something. And then you'll have the libretto for the bulk of it, just the basic script. And as a stage manager, oftentimes you're in rehearsal so much that unless it's a very complicated cueing sequence with the music, you pretty much have it memorized by the time you get to, you know, get into running the show. So it's not as big of a deal. But
that's actually something that I is a flaw of mine, is that I never learned how to read music. So when I'm doing musicals, it's a lot of visual cues. Sometimes I'll write in, like, wait for the drop in the music which is useless if someone else ever has to call that show. But for me, because as you said, we get to know it so well that it's just almost like little reminder cues. I really do need to learn how to read music at some point because it would make life a lot easier. But you know, I've done a whole two musicals so far, so I've gotten through so far. But
you did great. We loved it. Thank you. Thank you.
You know how to, if you know how to count, you can get through it. You know, count to eight.
Yeah, which I've done too. Sometimes it'll be.
That was my method. I gave up stage management a long time ago, mainly when I became a company manager. That made life easier. And I always had the hybrid of a script that had both pages that, you know, some of those score scripts were in there, but most of it was called off of the script itself. The last little bit with performances is, as you guys mentioned, is maintaining the show as directed and also staying in communication with the people who are still around. So you've got your producers that are still there, and then the show reports kind of wrap up the last little bit of information. This is from Alex's She Loves Me. I just randomly picked a show and it seemed actually kind of rather interesting. Like, it's a good, there's lots of notes on here. You know, we note the house count. I always thought like the weather will make people get a little delayed if it's too rainy. And any communication that needs to be with the house manager, with our front of house and ushers, who are in charge of the audience. I mean, they're there to make sure that the audience is smooth. If for some reason, I just remember a recent production again at SBMT there was an event going on at the community center and our parking lot was full right when She Loves Me?
I think so.
Right when we were about to start the show, there is no parking for all of our audience members. So we were I almost started a valet service to go up to the middle school parking lot, but we kept in contact with the stage manager, Alex, to keep that, you know, you're going to need to hold the house. She then relays that out to the cast and crew backstage so that they know that they can relax for a little bit.
Yeah, and I think, so the technical notes, the dream is that there are no technical notes, because usually it's things that go wrong. But it's important, I was always taught that it's important to be honest and accurate about them. From investment points of view, you never know who's in the house, and if they're seeing that things aren't going the way that they had seen it in rehearsals or whatever, they want to know why. And they want to know if their investment in this team, in this show, whatever, is going well. So it's also an opportunity to show that there was a problem and we fixed it, or there's a problem and we need help. So like if you look at number 7, I said the extra support beam in the back of the hospital is loose. Carla, who was my ASM at the time, will see what she can do about it tomorrow. So now the powers that be, they know what's on the radar, and they also know to look out for an email in case we do need more help.
This would then be sent to our design staff, myself, production manager, and you know, we would check in with everything. Did we make sure that so and so got their button re-sewn on, and so on and so forth? Go on. Sorry.
No, I was saying, I guess show reports also, that's a large crowd to be sent them to. SBMT definitely sends them out to kind of the whole team. But I've also had, like for equity shows, usually that just goes to like the artistic director and the director and maybe the general manager. They're oftentimes very confidential and it'll have information that you don't necessarily want the whole kind of team to know. Also, because the designers usually are gone. Like if you'd have to pay them to come fix it. So usually that's not an option. So you don't send it out to them. But again, community theaters and different theaters are all run things, you know, their way that works for them.
Yeah. Evelyn had just a question that follows this. Audience reaction is an interesting section that could be so subjective. How much detail do you generally provide it for something like that? Sometimes audience are just quiet, and how do you interpret?
So again, that's for investors. They want to know if the show was worth it and how it's kind of coming across. I find it really difficult. I oftentimes don't add too much. If the audience is very quiet, oftentimes I'll see kind of the reaction after the show. For instance, matinees tend to be older audiences who just are less responsive as opposed to younger audiences that sometimes are a little more boisterous. So that is a difference. I also one night had an audience when I was still in university that I think 3/4 of the audience was drunk. And so they were really loud and really obnoxious, and their friends were in the show. And so I commented on that. I mean, that was a night where they were so loud, I had troubles hearing the actors. Oh, wow. Because they were just, it was out of control. It was ridiculous. But anyways, so those are things that we note. And then it also oftentimes affects the performance, right? If there's a lot of laughter and they're super interactive, then we might have a couple extra minutes at the end of it, because people have to pause for laughter or whatever. Hope that answers your question.
Good. So they really do, a stage management that takes over from opening through closing. And again, we love them. We're grateful for all of the stage managers. So some challenges, you guys. You know, one of the things that is changing over the past year as theaters have shut down, there's been a lot of reflection on kind of some practices. One of the things that we've talked about, and especially now that COVID is a legitimate concern for future, is sick days, sick time generally. You know, you're in a show. You're sick, you're coming to rehearsal. And so, you know, some of this is speculative, we don't know. What, help me predict the future here, if you will. What is, what changes do you guys think might happen, in particular for sick time, understudies?
Any thoughts? Yeah, I think understudies are gonna have to become more common in all types of theater. I mean, even, you know, no matter what, I mean, it took years before American musical theater started utilizing understudies, you know, but it was necessary because shows were getting canceled because of not having understudies.
Yeah.
But the same thing is going to apply now. I mean, if somebody is in rehearsal or in performance, yeah, and they're sick, I mean, you need to either cancel or be able to go on. And I know there's a lot of hesitancy with understudies because people feel like they're, you know, if they're being paid, they're paying people for maybe not doing anything or not having to do that role. If they're not being paid, then you're asking somebody to do a lot of extra work for on a show. But I think it's going to have to become more common, you know, to have understudies. And on staff too. I mean, something that I started doing as a stage manager was training my assistants to call the show. But it's hard to do when a show only runs for a couple of weeks. It's like, mm-hmm. You barely get it up, and then you're going to try to teach somebody else to do it. And, you know, if something really happened with, you know, I mean, we've all called shows when we've been sick. I mean, it's just, but yeah, that needs to change. I mean, so I guess, you know, it had to be something you would try to do sooner. Just like, I mean, eventually with American Musical Theater, we started doing, you know, it went from just having a couple understudies for the principals to covering almost everybody in the company one way or the other, and getting them into rehearsal right away. So, you know, not waiting until the show opened, but getting them into vocal rehearsals and dance rehearsals, you know, before the show even opened. So it's hard. It's a big time commitment.
Yeah, there's always been the shows that have the flu bug that runs through them. Bob, I remember specifically a chorus line. It was, you know, probably 2006, where many members of the line went down, and that one had, you know, we put in people from the little group that comes on in the beginning, and then they're never seen again. So good times. And yeah, it'll be interesting to see how we all adapt, and actors too. Actors as well. The other one that I think is a really interesting conversation, and I don't know how familiar you are, there are days that are called 10 out of 12s that are for performers. Generally at the community theater level, at the SBMT level, we have about 2 days that are 10 of 12s. I seem to recall them being much longer, that there were multiple days where actors would work. Actors and technicians, these are your long tech days, the long, all the pieces together, that they're just calling, the movement is on the national level of really calling this out as almost an inhumane practice, that nobody should be required to work this many hours. And stage management in particular has to be there before everybody else to prep. And then you're also wrapping things up. You're writing your reports. And so your 10 of 12 becomes 14 out of 16. I mean, it just becomes much longer. Any particular thoughts, both either on a national or just even on a how do companies make that work? Do you think it's going to work?
Well, I think even saying 14 out of 12 is being generous, because also stage managers always work through their breaks. I mean, for those days, I try to take at least a half hour break, if not 45 minutes, if I can really swing it. But as you said, yeah, the days are extra long, and definitely don't get breaks. I mean, they're long days, and I also just, I think on a community level, it'd be a lot easier to fix that. And I'm just not sure on kind of a more professional level, there should be a solution. Maybe it's almost midnight here. I'm going to stop talking.
I mean, it's just changing people's expectations. I mean, it's, you know, if you're going to take away hours though, the producer, they're going to want them somewhere. So
exactly.
You know, another day on, you know, I think that's fine. I mean, but yeah, to shorten the span of those days would be great. I mean, they just kill everybody.
Yeah.
Mentally and physically, it's just exhausting. So
I wonder what it would look like if we stretched the process out more as opposed to condensed and long, because that's essentially what you'd be looking at. And from whenever I've kind of complained about the 10 out of 12s or whatever, or just been like, why do we do this? That's been the thought process, is that doing 10 out of 12s is a lot cheaper than renting the theater for an extra week or pushing off for another week. So it's honestly just theaters rearranging their priorities and figuring out their finances, because that's always a theater problem, right?
Yep.
Yeah, so many extra pockets of money floating around here in theaters. No, not so much.
Yeah, that's it. That's the issue.
That is the issue. We do have questions in the chat. Anything, before I move on to that, anything that you guys additionally want to add, just about anything you love or any horror stories?
Ooh.
Now's your chance.
Bob had some okay ones. I feel like when we were talking about this, we were like, I want to hear the Bob stories. That's
which horror story you want, Sarah?
Stories.
Which horror story do you want? Let's see. okay. Victor Victoria dress was a preview. We actually had one preview, I think, for AMT then. Maybe two. I don't remember. There's a scene, there's a dressing room set on stage. Yes, I think it's our second audience. There's a scene where an actor is supposed to have his hands slammed in a door, pretend to have his hands slammed in a door. His hand's out of sight, the door gets slammed, he goes, ow, my hand, you know. This actor who's supposed to get his hand slammed in the door had done the role before elsewhere. He was playing, I forget, he was like the big bodyguard or something. Anyhow, he had done the role before, and he was, I don't know if he was bored, he was trying to make it more realistic, but he decided to actually have his finger in the door and he's going to pull it out in time, and he didn't, and the door slammed on it, and the door slams, and I'm standing off stage right calling the show, and I look up and he's walking over to me holding his hand. He says I lost the end of my thumb. And I said and there's like blood coming out, and I'm like, okay. So I told everyone a headset, we're going to have to stop the show, and we brought the curtain down. And then my assistant went out on stage with a cup and some ice and found the end of his thumb and put it in the ice, a cup of ice. And then in the meantime, we called 911. And the director came backstage and the artistic director and the producer. And we had this, at this point, we actually did have understudies, but he hadn't actually rehearsed much. So we made an announcement to the audience that we were going to have to hold. We had some technical difficulties. And we had the artistic director and the producer helped him get dressed and got him off to the hospital. And we got the understudy with a script, and the understudy went on with the script in hand for the rest of the show. So luckily at that point we had understudies. One other quick story. The reason we started having understudies was way back in 91, maybe. We did a show called Phantom, which is another version of Phantom of the Opera. Yes, thank you. And it was a student preview. We used to do ones for high school kids and it was a 10 out of 12 day. And we actually were getting through the show. We'd never actually teched through the entire show. And we were doing it with an audience. And we got to the very end of act one, and there was an elevator downstage where the Phantom was supposed to carry Christine, stand on the elevator. The elevator was supposed to sink in the orchestra pit, and then it was the end of the act. And the elevator was downstage of the main curtain. So we got through the entire act, and I was like, literally took a deep breath, a sigh of relief, and called the final cue for the lift to go down with the Phantom on it. And they started going down, and the next thing I know was there was screaming. There was a loud bang and a scream, and Christine disappeared. Well, no, Christine did not. Christine was on the stage, the Phantom had disappeared. And everyone's like, stop, we got to stop. And there was somebody down the pit on headset saying, you know, so-and-so fell or is stuck. So we stopped the show and I brought the house lights up. Unfortunately, they were downstage of the curtain, so I couldn't hide anything. So the crew came out and we kind of gathered around them. The Christine was on stage with her foot trapped between the stage and the trap, which had come back up and kind of crushed her foot. And so we had all these high school, you know, 1,500 high school students sitting in the house, and some adults who mentioned that they were there. We had to stop the show, and we had to dismiss the audience, and we called an ambulance, and they came in and they took her away, and she couldn't perform anymore. And there was somebody in the ensemble, it was like 42nd Street, somebody in the ensemble that said, I know the part. And so we came in the next day and we rehearsed putting this woman, Kimberly, into the show in the role of Christine after several large equity meetings talking about the safety of the set and et cetera, et cetera. Yeah, we did cancel opening night because we ended up doing a technical rehearsal on opening night to make sure the show was safe. I mean, it was just, and that was a hard thing because, you know, I'm a member of Actors Equity. I have the cast, equity and non-equity, coming to me. Obviously, I was concerned about the safety as well. You have the director and the artistic director saying, you know, the show must go on. And, you know, finally the cast was like, we're not stepping foot on that stage again until, you know, these things are checked. Crew too. I mean, there were multiple things that happened during the run of that show, even, and the tech of that show that were just, you know, a fall spot fell out of a onstage tower, didn't hit anybody. I mean, this was an instance of when the schedule was too tight for the size of the show. Yeah. And because of that, there were the changes that were made following that, both with the schedule and with understudies that were for the better, but it was unfortunate. It took, you know, somebody getting seriously injured for that to happen. That's it.
I'm sorry those things happened, but I'm really glad I put you on the spot.
Thank you very much.
I also feel like we need to have a moment to shout out the importance of ASMs, because who went and found that thumb and also probably cleaned up all the blood on the stage?
Yep.
ASMs. Love your ASMs.
Yep, absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah.
Again, another wonderful support to all of our stage managers too, any ASM.
But through all of that, I'm sorry, through all of that, I mean, our job is to remain calm, even though we're freaking out, mm-hmm. and to facilitate communication and make sure things are getting done that need to get done. You know, that somebody is getting to the hospital, somebody's calling 911, that somebody, you know, that things are happening. And other people do step up, thank goodness. But, you know, ultimately you need to be You can't freak out and go screaming out of the building. I mean, it's just not, I mean, I guess you could, but.
Stage managers very much set the tone. They set the tone in a lot of ways for starting from rehearsal and continue on. So if the stage manager is panicked, everyone else will.
Yeah.
And if the stage manager is calm, everyone else will just kind of, okay. Mommy's got this, daddy's got this. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's something that I've been thinking about quite a bit I mentioned the beginning of this very community feeling. And I think each of the shows, you know, it goes back to the precedent set by the management, but the stage manager is the one who's there from pre to all the way to closing. So I know how incredibly valued that you are to make sure that people feel like they belong, that they're welcomed, that they're accepted. We're going to see a lot of that in the coming years, I imagine. This is nothing new, but a real importance on making sure that everybody, no matter their gender, their race, really feels included. So that's, thank you both for being such wonderful examples of how to make sure that people feel welcomed and included. So Kim had a question too early on. What do you personally find the most challenging about stage management and your favorite part of the job?
I think easily my least favorite part of the job, which is kind of also one of the most challenging, is line notes. They're so, especially doing Shakespeare, I've done a lot of Shakespeare shows. There's so many line notes sometimes. And line notes are for those who may not know, when the actor just says something wrong, oftentimes they'll just like sub in a word for another word. That context usually still makes sense, but you've got to kind of make sure that the playwright's words are being honored. So you write down their mistakes, and you usually have to say like, you said this, you should say this. Mm-hmm. And they're time consuming, and you're trying to write blocking notes at the same time. And then while you're writing the line note, someone will call for line, and then you'll have to find your spot in the script. It's just once the off book section happens, you end up having to do six different things at once. Which is why oftentimes, again, I love your ASMs, because if I won't do this with all of my ASMs, but if I have a really solid one, I will totally pawn off the line notes to them, or I'll have them, when someone calls out line, I'll have them read it. It depends on kind of the relationship with the ASM. But I feel like I'm completely split in three different directions when we add that component. And my favorite part is, I think I just like to be involved in everything. Stage managers are truly the only company members, including the director, who are part of every single thing that happens. We are there from the very first production meeting. Some stage managers are even involved in auditions. Depends on the company and the stage manager, but some start there. Most usually, like if you have a contract, it'll start the first day of production, the first production meeting, and will go right until closing night. And so I find like it's the most intimate view of the show. You really are the person that at the end of the day knows it best, because you know every single component that goes into that. And I like that. I also like feeling like an octopus sometimes, with like eight different like arms and legs and places. I can be in like three different places at once.
Rebrand.
I can't, but you think I will. Yeah.
I mean, I love calling the shows. Once they're up and running, I love calling the show. And yeah. Yeah, and I love that part as well, as kind of being involved in everything. I mean, it's you know, I find pleasure and joy in working with the actors, with the crew, you know, with the different staff members. It just is, it's exciting and fun to be that person that kind of touches all of those elements. And my least favorite, I mean, I guess it's more of a pet peeve, is I really don't enjoy, and I've had issues at times with, sometimes when shows run longer, you know, you have people that kind of embellish their performance, or they do other things, or they play around, and or they'll do things to other actors on stage. They'll change things that affect the other person's performance. Those kinds of things. I don't enjoy giving notes and dealing with those issues, but it happens. I don't mind a little bit of, you know, fun stuff happening on stage, and it's fine if the audience isn't aware and it's not really affecting the show. It's like, it's okay. You know, it's not a big deal. I mean, but you need to keep with the vision of the show. So.
I agree. Giving notes is really tricky. I've also had actors. So I've definitely throughout my kind of time of stage managing, some shows I've given honestly too many notes, and sometimes I feel like I haven't given enough. But a lot of actors also just don't want to hear it from the stage manager. Yeah. And that really depends on the tone that the director, I think, leaves with. Mm-hmm. I've had directors who kind of ignore the stage manager and don't really make the stage manager part of the team. And then when all of a sudden you're giving acting notes, people feel like their toes are being stepped on. Yeah. And they're like, why are you doing this? You're the person who writes notes. You're the assistant. And then I've had other directors who will do big speeches at Tech Week and be like, this is their show now. This is it. Like, I'm passing the baton, you know? Yeah. They're tricky. I agree.
Yeah. Any specific shows that were your favorite shows to SM, and what made that so memorable, enjoyable? Was it efficient script, the director, et cetera, actors? Favorite show?
I'm going to cheat and choose one from Canada so no one can get mad at me.
There's two right answers there, Alex. Bobby, go for it.
I'm going to choose the Canada one anyway. So it was actually the first show that I ever stage managed like fully. I think the experience that made it was, in a lot of ways, the director. He was one of my favorite directors that I've ever worked with. He made me part of the team right away. We had a good joking relationship. I had great ASMs. The cast was all, it was a smaller cast. And they were all just really excited to be there. And everybody was really respectful. And there was really interesting tech things that were happening. I mean, I had a trap door to run. I had fly cues. I had fog machines. Like it was one of those shows that just everything came to, it was the stage manager's dream. You know, it was fun to do. There was tricky tech things. It was fantastic. No complaints for that show.
I don't know. I mean, actually, I think Joseph was one of my favorite shows. It was a great cast, and I love the music, and it was just a fun show to do. I know it's fluff from an audience standpoint, and a lot of people don't love the show, but it was fun to do from a stage management point of view. You know, and actually, in a weird way, I like Annie. Don't ask me why. It's like, I shouldn't, but it's like, it's actually a fun show, I guess, because it's busy enough. I mean, I've always had issues with the show, either because of the dog or the kids or something, but, you know, it's actually, I don't know why I like that show. And Tommy, I enjoyed calling Tommy. Technically a very tough show, and the guy that played Tommy was an ass. I mean, was difficult to work with, but it was, as far as the stage management and calling a show and the crew and stuff, it was great. So,
I will agree with it. Joseph was a very special cast. We had James Iglehart come and talk with us back in November. So it was one of the first shows that I did with him. I guess it would be my second. And it just a dream cast. The narrator who was in the clip that Bob called earlier, that's Paige O'Hara, who is the voice of Belle in Beauty and the Beast, the animated movie. So back from 1990-something. She was one of the memorable people that I worked with as far as when she was here in San Jose, did not drive freeways. And my job was to make sure everybody got where they needed to be as a company manager, and that they were taking care of their housing and stuff. So I did a lot of MapQuest. There was no GPS back in those days. It was old times, and a lot of mapping things for her, doing city streets. With those few little memorable things. We had a great question. You guys are chatty tonight. I love it. Advice for students who are hoping to join the industry in the next few years. And how do you think COVID will affect employment for those who have just finished their education? Good luck.
I mean, I would say get involved in anything and just pad up that resume and meet people, you know, even if you're taking an internship at first or ASMing, whatever, like running the light boards, learn as much as you can about theater, and make friends because people, especially on the tech side, they don't care what you look like. They just care that you're good at your job, you're trustworthy, and you're a pleasure to work with. So just make friends, be reliable and show up and be willing to kind of do things. I have no idea. I mean, COVID has just thrown everything through a loop.
I mean, I think there'll be work there, obviously. I mean, there's going to be people that have left the business too because of COVID.
Yep.
You know, I think, I don't know. I think it's going to start up again. Might be a little slow for a few months, but I think it's going to get back to being what it was. Maybe I'm naively optimistic, but I think it'll be, in 3 or 4 months after shows start happening again, I think it's going to be like, unfortunately, it'll be like nothing ever happened. But,
possibly. Yeah.
But I agree with Alex. I think, you know, if you want to stage manage, do as much as you can in every other aspect of theater, act, run follow spot, run light board, you know, push scenery, yeah, sell tickets, whatever, because the more you know about every other area, the better stage manager you're going to be. Because part of it is understanding when you're asking a question of somebody, what they're dealing with, you know, and if you ask somebody to do something that doesn't make sense because you don't have a clue as to what the job is, it just makes it more difficult. So.
Awesome. I will echo that.
I apologize. My cat has opinions on this.
The cat agrees as well. I will take this moment too to also plug that if you are interested in learning about stage management, learning more about stage management, please let me know. We are actually starting to put together thoughts for an upcoming season. Nothing is being confirmed, and won't be confirmed for a little while, but because shows take so long to prep, we are prepping. So, and we're also doing all of these online programs, which need stage managers as well. They do make the world run. I think I have one more question. And Ron asked a great question. Technology these days, is technology helping the extended creative team develop, revise, and track changes to blocking notes, rehearsal reports, schedules, etc.? Email is being used, but with some folks missing meetings and not reading emails, are there tech solutions for theater, for collaborative tech components?
That was my husband.
Okay. So actually, Ron, Bob, you can jump in too. Yes, email has been great. We do see that. I predict that there will be more people calling in for production meetings, and that'll be okay, that we'll have a combo between live and Zoom. And even just, you know, I laughed, the 10 years that I stopped working from 2007 until 2017, and the difference of email communication has been great. So collaborative, you know, utilizing Google Docs has helped us from production management to stage management. All of that overlay, definitely a lot of sharing going on through the Google Docs.
Yeah, it's just easier. I mean, with, you know, text chains and email to communicate to a cast now. I mean, you used to have to do, you know, call everybody or you'd have an answering machine with a message on it, or, you know, it just was very burdensome. And now it's definitely much easier to communicate changes or information than it used to be. And I think that'll just keep getting easier. But like we said earlier, it also means that everyone has access to you more easily. So, you know, there's less downtime.
Setting boundaries is... something I think we all, I mean, stage managers, I think our personalities in general struggle with it. And with technology, I think it's getting more and more important that we figure that out.
One, I know I said the last question was going to be the last question, but Doug Hughes has written in the chat, if you had someone with zero backstage experience, but lots of enthusiasm, what's the first job you would assign them to do?
There's a lot of jobs. I mean, it depends what they're interested in, but I mean, I could put them as running crew. Mm-hmm. If they were interested in lighting, I'd set them up with lighting and teach them that. I mean, there's a lot of things that you can teach someone in a matter of a few weeks, enough that they'll be able to do it. I don't know. I've worked with follow spots because, as Bob was saying, follow spots oftentimes are one of the few tech things that are a little bit left to their own devices. We'll tell them when to turn on and off, but we won't necessarily always say what color, intensity, size, blah, blah. So I prefer to work with slightly more experienced follow spots. But again, I mean, I've worked with people who are brand new too, and they figure it out. So, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, the enthusiasm is a big part of it. And if you, you know, if you want to do the job, you'll figure it out. I mean,
yeah,
none of it's that difficult, quite honestly. I mean, if you break it down, I mean, it's, if you can pay attention and you have some attention for detail, you'll be fine. You can learn any job. So.
Yeah. A little bit of anticipation, you know, anticipating what the needs are is great. And yeah, I would echo that too, is really finding what the person is enthusiastic about, starting them, trying to match them up. But if they're like, I have no idea, I would always put someone deck crew to start with. Mm-hmm. And, just because you get to see so much of the action that's going on and what it feels like to be backstage and that energy and that excitement. And then you build up to ASM and on from there for sure. If you had a magic wand that allowed you to work any show the way you wanted to be, what would that one show be? That's a good face. Mm. Any show with Sara Dean?
Yes.
That's the answer.
I'm tempted to say Peter Pan. I'm tempted to say that one because you have people flying, which is so much fun. You got sword fights, which I love stage combat. Actually, in a lot of the SPMT shows, I've ended up doing the kind of stage combat-y bits of like the trick falls and the little punches and stuff like that, because I've got some experience with that. I feel like there'd be a lot of fun tech things. You'd have a fun giant crocodile to figure out.
Yeah,
you'd have to make it a little less offensive. That's always fun. But yeah, I feel like, yeah. Ooh, the play that goes wrong is a good one too.
I mean, from a stage management perspective, I think it would be fun to try to be able to call Hamilton, just because of there's so many cues in that show.
Yep.
It would be challenging and it'd be exciting. I think, you know, that would be something different. I mean, I do love a good Peter Pan and, you know, a show like Wizard of Oz, which again is like, you know, a disaster that should never be on stage, but as a stage manager, it's fun to do, I think.
Yeah.
I'm listing like the shows that we won't ever do, and it's Annie and what did you say? Joseph and Wizard of Oz. Like, can't do those. There's too much. But
yeah,
you know, if you're a glutton for punishment, there you go.
That's stage managers.
Stage manager. Yes. No shows with kids or dogs. No, not good plan. Bob and Alex, thank you guys so, so much. I invite anybody who's watching, who's still here. Thank you. Thank you. I have to send Alex to bed. If you would like to turn on your camera to say hi, we would love to see you. All right. That's it. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you guys so much for coming. Alex, Bob, we appreciate your words, your wisdom and information, and thank you for all that you do. You've made my life pretty damn amazing. Made my job easier all the time.
Thank you.
Alex, we miss you.
Everybody for being here. Appreciate it.
Yeah, thanks.